Good morning, Secretary Quigley. How are you?
Good. How are you?
Great. As a mom and a member of the Moms Clean Air Force, I and my fellow moms are working together to fight for our children's right to clean air today and tomorrow. For us, the Clean Power Plan is the Clean Air Act for our generation. Can you tell me the status of our air quality across the state, and for me, particularly in urban areas like Philadelphia, and what are the threats to our air, and what actions is your agency taking to monitor and regulate our air, as well as inform the general public?
Well, and thanks for that question. It's rather complicated. Let me see if I can be very concise, Representative. And overall, because of the steadily ratcheting down of federal requirements and the Commonwealth's implementation of those ever-strengthened federal requirements, I think Pennsylvania's air quality is better than it's been in decades, certainly since... It's better now than it's ever been, I think it's fair to say, before the Industrial Revolution. We continue to have some issues in urban areas that are driven primarily by the emissions from coal-fired power plants, which is why the Clean Power Plan is so important. The challenge that we face when it comes to regulating air quality, again, comes back to staffing. We have a very sophisticated air quality monitoring network throughout the Commonwealth that we are actually going to expand this year. We're going to add 10 counties in the shale areas. We're going to add PM 2.5 monitors in 10 additional counties over the next 2 years so that we can get better data on the impacts of, for example, unconventional oil and gas development and understand the impacts on public health in those communities. So we've got to get better data. But the challenge that we face is, again, one of staffing. We were written up by EPA for being severely understaffed in our air quality monitoring network program. So it all, again, all roads lead to staff. The agency's capacity to do its work under the Federal Clean Air Act has been degraded because of year-over-year budget cuts. The fees that we charge, they are all rulemaking in nature. We've got to do a rulemaking package to upgrade the fees. And it is very rare where a fee will actually cover the complete cost of the program. There's inevitably some level of general fund subsidy pretty much across all of our programs. So the fees never quite get 100% of the cost of doing business, and we have to update them regularly every 3 years. So we're on a treadmill when it comes to making sure that we have sufficient resources to manage and protect air quality in the state.
And you mentioned that all roads lead to your staffing. So I'd like to talk a little bit about your staff. And for me, regardless of the size of your staff, I believe that the staff should be reflective of our Commonwealth population. And at this point, our population is over 50% women and over 20% minorities. Can you tell me what your demographics look like as far as your employment and diversity on your work staff?
Yes, and I appreciate the question. This is, I think, the first time that I've been asked that as a cabinet secretary, and I really do appreciate it. This is something that is very important to me personally. It's very important to the governor. He has launched a number of diversity initiatives across the Commonwealth. To be very honest, we're behind the curve. The DEP workforce is 64% white male, 29% white female, so, and 4% minority male, 3% minority female. So again, 7% of our total workforce at DEP is minority. The overall Commonwealth workforce is 54% white male, 32% white female, and 6% minority male, 8% minority female. So the split is 86% white, 14% minority across the Commonwealth. So we are less than that at DEP. And there are a number of reasons for that. Obviously, in my agency, we rely very heavily on scientific expertise. And that qualification and the limited diversity in college majors that are needed for DEP employment, plus an overly complex civil service system, makes it more difficult for us to recruit. With reduced budgets, we have less of a recruitment budget, very frankly, to reach out to these communities and institutions. And frankly, the best and brightest minority individuals coming out of grad school and college will have better paying opportunities in the private sector. So faced with that situation, we've taken a number of steps. And one of the first meetings I had on taking office actually was about this issue, to see what we were doing and what we could do better. But we are working on making better connections with minority universities. We have expanded our recruitment efforts to the high school level. We're working, for example, in Harrisburg with a number of schools to reach out and do a high school intern program, a paid intern program with the Harrisburg School District. The governor is working on establishing a new Commonwealth Public Service intern program that would lead to full-time Commonwealth employment and provide some flexibility in the hiring process. So we are very focused on increasing the diversity of the agency, both at the staff level and at the leadership level. This year, we did fill the Office of Environmental Justice with a minority individual who is just doing a fantastic job of redesigning that office. So this is a subject that we talk about a lot at DEP.
I appreciate your commitment to that effort, Secretary, and particularly look forward to your recruitment and high school internship programs in the future, bringing more diversity to your workforce. Thank you for your time.